Welcome to another episode of PG Radio. On this episode of my podcast, I had the privilege of speaking to the host of the Charvak podcast, Kushal Mehra. And Kushal's an interesting guy in his own regard. I'm sure more people who hear podcasts in India have heard Charvak than they've heard mine. Mine's still pretty young. Kushal's been around for a while. And the Charvak podcast does some phenomenal work with respect to what I might loosely call alternative form of reporting. The theme of this conversation was a question I was asked once when I was starting off my podcast. When I was starting off my podcast, somebody asked me a caricatured question. And caricatured questions have a way of extracting information from the answerer in a way that regular, genuine, authentic questions, sharp pointed questions kind of don't. And so somebody asked me, they were like, so you are going to start podcasting. What is it that you figured out that the rest of the world has not? What is it that you figured out that everybody else around you has not? And I think that is a very reasonable question. I think that was rather a very important question that I was glad I argued at a very young moment in my journey. I think all artists, in fact, I think almost all entrepreneurs, all cell phone people need to answer this question. What is it that you figured out that nobody else has? And the answer could be something like, I'm just skillful. But you need to know what your competitive advantage is. Why is it that people will appreciate you? And I think what this breed of podcasters, me and like, if I can find myself clubbed with the same breed of the same pedigree of people, is that we figured out that legacy media has betrayed us. And I think everybody else in the country has kind of sort of figured it out too, but they just haven't articulated it yet. I think legacy media, like the likes of Arnab Goswami, the likes of Republic TV, and I don't mean Republic TV, it's just a placeholder for all legacy media, have betrayed their population. I remember a time when I could look up to these men to make sense of my reality for me, to connect the dots between facts that exist and create a story that was believable, that was not polarizing, that was not propaganda, and that was not agenda, that was not TRPs, that was not ad revenue, that was not sponsorships. But now, those same people, that same architecture that would make sense of my life for me is missing. And part of the reason why I set out on the journey that I did is so I could ask the questions I wanted answered to the people who would answer these questions. And so this was the theme I had with the conversation I had with Kushal. I wanted to ask him, had he figured out the same absence in the sense-making sphere as I? Had he felt the same betrayal? And through the means of me and him, our listeners, have we felt the same betrayal from the same variety of people? I wanted to exchange, say, notes on podcasting. I wanted to talk about the meta aspects of podcasting. But the conversation happened to take a course of its own. Kushal is an extremely charming man. There is a way about his conversation that is almost, you cannot ignore but enter the rabbit hole with him. And so we ended up speaking about a lot of different things. We spoke about social justice warriors, what is happening in America with the Black Lives protests, how Kushal sees the political spectrum in India, if he even sees a right wing at all. And by the end of it, my view on the Indian political scene had considerably changed. I had integrated a considerable amount of newness in my political view of India. I think you will like this conversation. I think this was a very, very on point conversation. I think you will like this. And I'm excited to see what you think. So after you're done listening to this conversation or anywhere in between, if you have the need to pause the conversation, give me feedback. Tell me what you think. Tell me what you think about the direction of the conversation. Tell me what you think I could have done better. Tell me what you think I could have added as a question, right? Or suggest me guests. Let me know what you think. Interact with me more. I'd love to serve you better. Thank you so much for watching. See you on the other side. Thank you so much, Kushal, for doing... Kushal, that's how you say your name, not Kushal, yeah. Right? Yeah, Kushal, thank you so much for doing this. I think right before we pressed record, we'd already gotten into the weeds to some extent. Here is the thing, right? We were talking about how to somebody who will find you on the internet, tell you, why are you not an atheist? Have you lost your way? One of the problems I see in internet discourse is that people try to meet that sort of an absurd question with merit, right? They will try and argue for a legitimate position. While the obvious response to that is exactly what you were saying. Tu hai kaun? Tu mere se kya pooch raha hai? You see what I mean? It isn't obvious to me ki ek online discussion, yeah, for that matter, any discussion. When you have to make a point, when you have to argue for a position, it has to be done seriously. Sometimes comedy being only one of many tools, is the best way to get your point across. And my fear is to some extent that the online bogey train has left that mark. Like there is a saying that I read somewhere recently is like, don't fight the pig. Both of you will get dirty and the pig will enjoy it. And that is sort of what I think is part of the culture of Twitter conversations, especially if you observe somebody like Donald Trump, for instance, his Twitter. It's like, stop giving him the ammunition. Like, it's clearly not working. Your moral high groundedness is not working. He's winning all the rounds. You see what I mean? Have you observed something like that?
See, my understanding of how the discourse on social media is I always use this simple analogy of stray dogs in India. So I always use it every time somebody asks me, what's your opinion of social media? So I always say, in India, you know, we have a lot of dogs on the streets, right? And they suddenly come up in the night. I don't know where they go in the daytime. I've never understood that, but they're always coming up in the evening. And then I think they get disturbed by the headlights of the car or something. And every time a car goes by, passes by them, they start barking at the car. And for them, it's a daily existence. Cars go by, they bark at them. And if a car stops, you'll see the dog doesn't know what to do.
What to do?
It's like the dog goes into, "Arey, main kya karu? Abhi kya karu? Abhi kya karu?" So my analysis of everybody on social media is, we are those barking dogs. Every day, an outrage passes by, and we have to compulsively give an opinion on it. Whether we know anything about it or not is immaterial. And everything, so basically the entire discourse is what I call LCD, lowest common denominator. So the entire discourse on social media is catering to the lowest common denominator. So to me, if somebody were to ask me, so Kushal, how do you use social media? I use social media not for engagement anymore. So I joined Twitter in 2010 and I used to engage perle. But then I realized, oh my God, this is just not the right way to engage, because there are no audiovisual cues. I mean, it's a very simple thing. Ki, a word like "to hack on." I mean, there are multiple ways of saying "to hack on." Now, I don't know what the intent of the other person is when they say "to hack on." It could be in a joking way. It could be, somebody might say, "Main emoji dal sakta." Nahin, it's not good enough. We just, and there, how many times in a day do we see two people having a conversation and just speaking past each other because they attribute malice to the other side?
And or stupidity.
Yeah, and attributing malice is the default position on social media, on the text medium. That's why I avoid that. To me, that medium is where I just make a pronouncement. I throw thought bubbles there. These are not fixed thoughts. These are loose thoughts. I throw them out there. I make people think. 90% of my mentions I don't read. I only read mentions of people who I actually know. And that too, when I read, I just 99% of the times, I'm just messing around. I just have fun with people I know or stuff like that. To me, that is just the general discourse overall on social media. I find it very off-putting, and that's why I avoid it. I just go there, make my point, move forward. And it's not just about any particular. What I don't like personally is, I don't like having opinions on everything. When I have an opinion on something, I have a strong opinion on it. But most of the times, if people follow me, at least at an individual level, they'll be like, "Ye har cheez pe nahi bolta." Abhi nahi bolna yaar, pata hi nahi kyun bolu. Abhi aise hi boli jao.
Zabardasti defend karwao mere se. Zabardasti defend karwao.
Nahi karna defend. Abhi I don't hide that I'm a political animal. I never hide it. But the point is, why would I defend everything the BJP or the Congress or Aam Aadmi Party does? I mean, just don't understand it. And there is this, this compulsion that if you don't comment on something on social media, that means you're complicitly or implicitly agreeing with me. Abhe kyon? I mean, maine dekha hi nahi. Maybe, did you think I only spent half an hour on Twitter? Not like you, I'm 6 hours on Twitter. Abhe kabhi ye bhi soch lo. Main vela nahi hu.
कि डिफॉल्ट ऑप्शन ये है कि भाई सब बुरे हैं और हमें बुराई से बचना है लाइक द डिफॉल्ट स्टेटस दैट समथिंग रॉन्ग इज हैपनिंग अराउंड मी एंड आई थिंक उसका द कन्वर्जन ऑफ दैट इन द सेंस ऑफ व्हाट यू सेड लाइक द लोएस्ट हैंगिंग फ्रूट द लोएस्ट कॉमन डिनोमिनेटर इज अ वेरी मॉरल सेंट्रिक कॉन्वर्सेशन अबाउट एवरीथिंग दैट मे और मे नॉट हैव टू डू विद मॉरल्स राइट सो फॉर इंस्टेंस वी हैड जेके रॉलिंग हैड दैट recent post. I don't know if you were privy to what happened with her, and she writes something about sex being biological, nothing on gender. Suddenly the attack on her is from a moral standpoint. Her position, if she had to defend that, is probably a scientific position. And what that generally means is, ye jo, these dogs that you analogize that are barking on social media probably do not realize that the car is a different beast, that the car does not care about what the dogs are barking about. This moralistic virtue signaling does not really help their case. I would go to the extent and even say, and I mean, that's not the point I want to talk about. I want to talk more about this virtue signaling aspect, because I read a very interesting tweet from you about what is happening in America. But it does not look like the virtue signaling aspect is working. It is almost as if the rules that operate in the real world, where you can be virtuous by communication, and the rules that operate in the on the virtual world are absolutely separate. I think we haven't had the time to figure them out. And I think we behave on social media just how we'd behave in real life. And those consequences are extreme. Those two worlds are very, very decoupled. And so leaving that point aside, I want to ask you, I'm sure virtue signaling is one of the things that you're battling. You mentioned that there is a very different kind of a religious memeplex that is happening in America, which I think is stemming from the same virtue signaling platform kind of a thing. What was the tweet about? Like, what do you mean there is another religion coming? What is that about? What is this thought?
Well, it's very simple. So if you look at the way American society has changed, what has happened is I think the last survey, and I'm talking only strictly based on America, I think it's a phenomenon which is hitting Western Europe and America, and basically the Anglosphere. To use Jat Bhasha, Gore Logon Ke Desh. Unke Desh.
Right.
So what is happening in those countries is they are more, the more secular they became, the more godless they became. It's very funny because I'm godless, but it is what it is. It is happening, right. And nobody wants to talk about it. A few scholars are, but other than them, hardly anybody is talking. So in my view, what is happening is we are social species. I mean, yeah, shared intentionality, whatever, it comes over through that. The point is, religion is a natural outcome of post-agricultural societies. Religion was the only way we could hold post-agricultural societies together. Now, religion has in pretty much many ways collapsed in these societies. Now, people think you could have fulfilled, you always hear these answers from, you know, neo-atheists and, oh, football will fill the role of religion. कौन सा मारते हो मतलब रिलीजियस पीपल डोंट कंज्यूम फुटबॉल रिलीजियस पीपल आई मीन इफ यू लुक एट द नंबर्स ऑफ से नेशनल फुटबॉल लीग देर आर मोर और मोर और लेस सेम अमाउंट ऑफ पीपल हु वॉच एनएफएल राइट रिलीजियस और इरिलीजियस मे बी मोर रिलीजियस पीपल वॉच एनएफएल द पॉइंट इज व्हाट आई कॉल इज इन माय व्यू व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इन अमेरिका नहीं इन द एंटायर एंग्लोस्फियर इज व्हाट आई कॉल अ क्राइसिस ऑफ मीनिंग Now, previously, what we called purpose or meaning in life used to come from what we can loosely call religion or a tool for transcendence, what the wow factor. We believe there is something larger, something more amazing. Now, Dawkins has said many times, but just look at the galaxy and see how amazing it is. Well, not many people are buying it. I'm a huge fan of Dawkins. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I've read his work. I am a huge admirer of his work. But the point is, they don't buy it, man. And it's creating a gap. It is creating a huge vacuum in Western societies. They are filling that with a new religion. And it is so similar. Like I had written about it too. Like the original sin in Christianity was, you know, the one that Eve committed, where she ate the apple and basically mankind became eternally damned, right? The original sin in the new religion that has engulfed the Anglosphere is privilege. That's the original sin. That is the original sin, and all white people are eternally damned. All rich people are eternally damned. It's so similar. If you break the codes of the old religions, you have blasphemy. If you break the code where you say, I deny my privilege, I deny XYZ, I'm not saying whether there is privilege or not. I'm just creating parallels. If you say, no, there is no such thing as privilege, then you have blasphemed in the new religion. So basically, you are behaving like religious nut jobs. You have just replaced one memeplex with another. It just shows how empty your lives are. That's all. I, as an outsider sitting in Mumbai, looking at these people behave the way they are, the reason what I was trying to tell my people in India was, look, they are experimenting. They threw out religion. And it's unbelievable that is coming from my mouth because I am so opposed to religion in my own brain.
Right.
But
right.
I can't be... you know, I can't be biased. The fact is I have to be objective when I'm looking at what's happening in these Anglosphere. And they are having a crisis of meaning. They have replaced the old order. They are yearning for a new order. And the beauty is the new order is exactly like the old order. The gods have changed.
Who are the gods now?
The gods are your privilege. The gods are, I mean, just think about it. The entire movement, the symbolism of white people washing the feet of black people. Do you think it's about black people? I saw this and I was like, you narcissistic pieces of shit. You again made it about you. It is about your guilt. So the new god is guilt. It is your guilt. You know, it is a self-flagging.
Shame.
It's right. Like, वो जो होते थे ना हमारे यहाँ पे इंडिया में आते थे वो रुदालियां होती थी ऐसे ऐसे छाती ठोक के ऐसे
रोते हैं
ये लोग वो हरकतें कर रहे हैं आई मीन इट्स सो ऑब्वियस व्हाट्स हैपनिंग देयर सो माय होल पॉइंट थ्रू दैट ट्वीट थ्रेड वाज कि लेट अस नॉट मेक द मिस्टेक्स दे आर मेकिंग दे बेसिकली थ्रू द बेबी आउट विद द बैथ वाटर
राइट
थ्रो ऑल द गार्बेज आउट ऑफ रिलीजन थ्रो ऑल द मिसोजिनी आउट throw all the bad stuff out, throw all right. the bigotry out, throw everything out. But there is still something in that memeplex that works for people. I mean, imagine. So I'll give you an example. So I think it was last year when Bill Burr had gone on Joe Rogan or the year before. He's been there many times. But in one of the podcasts, it was very interesting where Bill says, oh yeah, it has to be 2 years ago because Bill said, I'm a 50-year-old at that time. Bill Burr said, I'm a 50-year-old now. Start going to the church again. I don't believe in it. And immediately he had to say, I don't believe in that shit. But I'm going there. And Joe was like, why? Like, I don't know. I kind of like it. A sense of community. Religion used to offer that sense of community. And no, a football club is not that. Because it's just not that. If it was there, everybody would have thronged to a football club. There is something, I can't pinpoint what religion offers there, but there is something that religion tends to offer far more than these football clubs or book clubs or whatever, alcohol anonymous clubs. I'm not saying the other things are not needed, but religion seems to be that icing on the cake. Now, what we need to figure out, in my view, is that icing, can it be sugar-free? When I mean sugar-free, I mean to say, can it be without the rubbish?
Right.
So Jefferson tried something like that when he removed all the rubbish from the Bible and he represented a Bible with all without the rubbish verses. Thomas Jefferson, imagine so many years ago, he also thought of doing that. But obviously, he failed in a way that people didn't accept his Bible. My point is that there is something out there that we just, even when we reject the religion, our behavior after rejection is just like the old religion. So these people who are behaving the way they are, all these trigger warnings, microaggressions, words are
violence.
Sounds
like blasphemy. Sounds like blasphemy to me.
Baba, it is religion. So the point is that you have just created a new Abrahamism where there is no divine God, but you have replaced that with some new gods which are of different kinds and you're just behaving like the old template. So it's kind of funny. And when you say that, the kind of resistance you get from them, it's actually super hilarious. So my point is, I can be an individual Gnostic or a disbeliever or an atheist or a skeptic in a society that is by and large religious because the order is maintained by the religion. And we are just pawns in the game, which you keep saying, leave me alone. I don't want to believe it. But the moment you change that order where we become all, everybody becomes that, then can society survive? I don't know.
Right. Right. And that is, I think you were right. Like there is a set of, let's just say, truths with small t that are embedded in religion in a more complex way than our naive first degree logical minds allow us to see. And so there has to be an exploration. Like, I think it's, what's this guy's name? Dennett says, he's like, once you abandon the church of God and move to your secular mansion, go back to the church and, you know, recover whatever you can, because there is some merit to be found there. There is no denying that. But here is my question. And this is the kind of question where, like, if I was somebody that you were talking about, if I was somebody who was involved with what is happening right now in New York, right, I would be like, hey, so I seem to see that you were suggesting take all the bad parts out of a religion, keep whatever is left. It is not that bad. We are doing exactly that. How is my religion not the religion that you, or not the modified version of the religion that you're propagating for? What is so fundamentally flawed about this memeplex?
Well, the biggest problem is you have actually taken all the bad parts of the old religion and you are behaving just like the bad part of the old religion. The bad part of the old religion was blasphemy. You're blasphemy. You're just practicing blasphemy. The bad part of the old religion was no scope for intellectual openness. You're doing all of the bad things that the old religion was doing.
Right.
You're actually not rejecting the old stuff. So it's, you know how they say, you know, that U-shaped curve where when the both the horseshoe. Extreme ends, horseshoe theory, the extreme ends on the left and the right, they are so similar to each other.
Right.
They are actually same, just the exact hoo-ba-hoo copy of each other. Both are authoritarian. Both hate freedom of expression. Both hate diversity of the mind. They don't like thought diversity. And so what 80% of the people who are protesting are right. But there is this 20% who is trying to control. That 20% is the problem. 80%. I myself support something like Black Lives Matter. I believe this whole thing that all lives matter. No. There is no problem in saying Black Lives Matter because there is a history of violence against them. So if somebody asserts Black Lives Matter, they are absolutely right in doing that. What's the big deal in that? In fact, people may not like it because it's not even popular in America. I'm someone who will go to the extent of saying there should be affirmative action for black people. Only black people, not Asians, not Latinos. You don't have that kind of a history in that country. Just like we have reservations for SCSTs in India, and I support it. I'm not opposed to it. Now, I am not your typical, you know, they say right-wing libertarian, toh matlab woh har cheez mein let the market. No. Something called historical injustice. Thok ke rakh diye tumne un logon ki.
So, right.
So, but the point is the way the extreme end of that movement is like what attacked J.K. Rowling was a new Abrahamism.
Matlab, that was J.K. Rowling. For me, when I was reading J.K. Rowling, I was 10. When I was reading Harry Potter, I was 10, 11, 12. That is, those were the ages. For me, there is a connection I have to J.K. Rowling. And so that is why it's relevant, because at this point, I have learned to discard all online, I call them forced arranged marriages to opinions, right? I will say something, I will say X. I mean X, I don't mean Y. People will attack me because they think I meant Y. So I will have to defend Y now, and eventually Prakhar and Y become synonymous. And X, what happened to X at all? Like X became lost in history. And so this forced, this happens all the time. That's why I'm very politically active when I'm in private conversations with family, friends, where I'm not being recorded. While I'm being recorded, I only like to ask political questions. I rarely deliver political answers. But I have to ask you something. Something very interesting happened that I noted that I don't know how to make sense of. And I think you might be able to help me in some sense. I saw this tweet by one of Reddit's board of directors, some guy, right? And I think that tweet became very, very popular. And what he did after all of this happened, he's like, listen, I am going to step down. I am going to resign from my position as board of director of Reddit so a black person can replace me. And that just sounds very strange to me. Like, I don't understand what, like, if I was, here's the deal. If I was doing it from first principle, if I was the board of a director of a company and I wanted black representation, instead of resigning, I'd just be like, let's introduce three more positions and let's give them to black candidates. Like, it's not the obvious first step, giving your own self away. Part of me is suspicious that that is also like a signal that's like, it sounds very facade-y. I'm not sure what that, what do you think about that?
I'm not aware of it from the way you have explained from the face of it. Sounds like it's more about the person resigning and less about African Americans. Again, it's about you. See, every time you make it about you, so you're signaling to the crowd that look how virtuous I am. And I'm not saying virtue signaling is only done by one type of people. Different kinds of people virtue signal differently. So I'll give you an example. So when these nationalists on Twitter will show their flag and they'll be like, oh, what a nationalist I am. Jaise ki pata nahi border pe abhi jaake ladai ladke aaya Pakistan se bhaiya tu. That is also virtue signaling of a different kind. Everybody virtue signals. All human beings virtue signal. That's just the way we are made. Because we are, see, everybody is peacocking. But before what happened was, in the pre-internet world, we could only peacock in our tribe or in our neighborhood. We did not have the option to peacock in such a massive way.
Square. Right.
Now we have a global public square where peacocking is how our brain functions and everybody is peacocking. And basically the cultural zeitgeist, especially in the West, has shifted from a culture of honor to a culture of victimhood.
Right.
So victimhood is now the peacocking signal, which will get you the most plaudits. That's so the cultural zeitgeist has shifted from where everything was about, you know, you and I have a problem, let's settle it in the old school way. Aaja park mein dekhte kaun kitna. That was the old school way, the culture of honor. I'm not saying that was right either.
There are
multiple problems in that culture also. But the point is, we replace that rubbish with this new rubbish. Everything is about you. Everything is about, it's like, pehle, you know, I used to laugh at candlelight vigils. I was like, candle kya jala raha hai? Now I have so much respect for candlelight vigils after these new placard wielding morons. Like photo khich li Instagram pe dal di placard. Maine bola kam se kam wo to walk to kar raha tha. Tu to walk bhi nahi kar raha, bhaiya. तूने तो ब्लैक टाइल
इन्वेस्टमेंट तो दे कॉज को लेके ब्लैक टाइल शेयर हो गया मेरा काम मैंने ब्लैक लाइव्स मैटर बोल दिया ब्लैक टाइल शेयर करते हैं
सो बेसिकली एवरीबॉडी इज पीकॉकिंग हियर एंड देयर इज दिस मिथ सी द राइट विंग लव्स टू अक्यूज द लेफ्ट विंग ऑफ वर्चू सिग्नलिंग विदाउट रियलाइजिंग दैट दे आल्सो वर्चू सिग्नल ऑल द टाइम एवरीबॉडी इज वर्चू सिग्नलिंग व्हाट आई डोंट गेट इज तुमको मिलता क्या है सबसे हां हां
हां
I don't understand it. I'm not saying
subconscious sex capital.
Yeah, I'm not saying maybe I must also be doing it, but at least I'm aware of it. All I'm saying is at least be aware of what. Don't think that you are something out of this world. So this guy who, I think your suggestion is far better. He should not have resigned from the post. What Reddit should have done was get 2-3 more African Americans or maybe a Latino or an Asian or whatever and create a diverse board. But again, it should still be on the basis of some merit. And I'm sure there are far more capable African Americans than that gentleman who's running Reddit also. But this is how I would have done it. But again, it is, would that have gotten him more plaudits online?
Right.
That have gotten them better media?
Hmm.
No, this gets them better media because that's what their cultural zeitgeist is. The see, culture is controlled by the aristocracy of that time. The aristocracy in the Anglosphere today is, and the media, no matter what people say, the media in the West is by and large, and the Hollywood in the West is very left-leaning. Whether you like it or not, it is left-leaning. The arts and crafts are usually left-leaning. That's just the nature of it. And today, these people are basically hooked onto this victimhood culture. And they like this oppression Olympics. They like the victimology poker. And they have convinced the entire space where, I mean, I'll say it straight up. I see Hindus in the West trying to be part of the oppression Olympics. Magar unko kutta bhi nahi puchta. So, abhi wo bhi try kar rahe nahi. Bhai, hum bhi hain. Humko bhi le lo.
right.
Hindus are trying their level best. But I mean, that's for one more day. But the point is that everybody is hooked onto this victimhood culture. Everybody wants a share piece of the pie. But I believe that's not the right way to live your life. You have to acknowledge past crimes. You have to help them come up. While at the same time, you cannot live your life as a victim all the time. Beyond a point, even, I mean, what do psychiatrists tell you? That you have to stop blaming yourself and playing the victim all the time. You have to develop some self-confidence and come up in life. Otherwise, you'll be in the doldrums all your life. And I think it's a very worrying sign. I hope India doesn't become that. That's my biggest fear.
My fear is quite the inverse. So I don't know if you know, but I've been living in New York for about 3 years now. I've been going to school here in New York. And so I've observed this entire discussion from when it started, at least for me, when it started in 2017, be that when, you know, Jordan Peterson was a thing and the intellectual dark web was a thing. And then, in fact, I was very involved with free speech issues on Columbia's campus. And I've somehow somewhat seen this array, and I've seen this come from African-American, white Americans, ethnic American, all that kind of jazz. I've been blamed for being a white supremacist. I'm brown. Like, where are you? What do you mean? This is not my country. What do you like? So the general point being, I kind of feel like when I experience a white privileged, shamed white individual, I experience the sort of the guilt I had for being Indian when I did not know better. You know, I think there is, and I may be very wrong. Tell me if I am. I think culturally, at least when I was growing up, there was this self-loathe that Indians carried where speaking in Hindi was looked down upon. Like the very fact that me and my friends would laugh about having sex in Hindi. And that goes on to say how denatured we are to Hindi being just another language like English. Like English has this weird occupation that, you know, how Friends is cool and Tarak Mehta Ka Ulta Chashma is bullshit. And it might be on merit, but it is discarded prima facie. And it sort of feels like the white person is experiencing kind of the same thing in their own context, where it's like everything about me, like I know white people who would rather not be recognized as white people. Oh, I am a redhead person, or I am Irish or Swedish or all those things. I just don't want to be white. Right. So it kind of feels like that. Have you felt that similarly? Is there something that I say?
But those are two separate issues, in my opinion. I don't deny that there is something like privilege that exists. I think there is something like privilege. Luck plays a factor in your life. I mean, otherwise, how would your probabilities of being more successful in America are clearly obvious than in India. Because you're just born into a more organized, better functioning, disciplined society because the systems are in place. So there is something like the privilege of being born and raised in Western countries. What I don't get is that sometimes I believe that both left and right in the West have a role in society. The left plays a very good role in identifying hierarchies and reminding society, look, this is getting too rigid.
Right.
Hierarchies are there. Like Nicholas Christakis has written a brilliant book called The Blueprint, if I remember the name correctly, where he has shown what is the ideal way of living this living life. And he has used shipwrecks as an example. And how he said shows when the hierarchies became very rigid, the shipwrecks got destroyed. When they became very flat, the shipwrecks got destroyed. The only time the shipwrecks were surviving was when there was a fluid hierarchy where the leadership was, you know, kind of dealing with everyone, right, which is normally how a functioning democracy is. But there is there is leadership, and the leadership is also clearly defined, but elected. So that it's very interesting how he shows. So what I think is happening is that the left is very good at pointing flaws in society. Yahan pe problem hai, yahan pe problem hai, yahan pe problem hai. Where they go wrong is in the solutions more often than not. The right is very good at offering solutions. Usually, not all the time. Again, I'm saying not all the time, but usually they tend to. So what should ideally happen in society is the left keeps pointing problems out, and the right keeps pointing and giving solutions out. The problem here is that I believe that the cultural orthodoxy keeps changing in society. So previously, if you look at American history, the right wing was the cultural orthodoxy. Look at how the movies were. They're very Christian. Yeah, I mean, if you look at old American movies, you could see scenes where the man is slapping a woman. You will not see it today. You will see casual misogyny in American movies in the 1950s, 60s, homophobia, racism, all these things. That time, there was this ultra-orthodox, conservative, religious, bigoted orthodoxy that was controlling the narrative. It got rightfully challenged in the 60s. The civil rights movement, everything changed. And then they became the orthodoxy now. Everybody who becomes the orthodoxy becomes rigid. Now the orthodoxy is the left, and they've become rigid and they refuse to change. And now the heterodoxy is the right wing, and they become, it is not because the right is inherently flexible or the left is inherently flexible.
It has to be right now.
The heterodoxy is inherently flexible. So I, as a person who is free-minded, always say that you should always kind of hang in the center and keep loosely watching both sides. And that's what what I think is happening in the West is that the orthodoxy has become too rigid. And so that it's not that privilege is not a valid objection. There is something called privilege. I think I will admit to it that in a casteist society like India, caste is a problem. And yes, only upper castes have the privilege of not knowing their caste. Because a lower caste person is reminded about their jat.
All the time.
So you will see this upper caste narrative that kahan hai caste, ye to angrezon ne ki. Achha, angrezon ne ki. To fir 2000 saal se jo hamari inter-caste marriage nahi ho rahi hai, jo DNA mein clearly proven hai, to uska kya hua? These are problems. So there are good things that the left can offer. There are good things that the right can offer. So my answer to all these things is you have to be open, and you should. That doesn't mean I am not biased to certain points of view. Don't get me wrong. And I'm open about my. All I'm trying to say is that we have to be objective, or we try to be objective. When we try to be objective, these things look far clearer. So I don't agree that there is no such thing as privilege. There is something like privilege. But what do we do with that privilege? We don't bang our heads on the wall with it. We acknowledge it. But uske baad kya maar dun kya main apne aap ko?
Haan, chala jaun main, ho gaya, matlab, खेलने तो दो, राइट
राइट.
हाँ, तो माय क्वेश्चन इज, समटाइम्स आई फील कि दिस कॉन, बिकॉज आई सॉ दिस कॉन्वर्सेशन ब्रूइंग व्हेन इट वाज ब्रूइंग, when people like Jordan Peterson were saying, hey, listen, something's going wrong and you guys got to pay attention, and nobody was paying attention. This was back when India hadn't even conceptualized an argument on Twitter about free speech. Like 3 years ago, only a few mavericks, probably somebody like you, was talking about free speech issues in India. And, you know, I find that very often what happens is that there is a very direct one-to-one cultural import that we borrow from the West. And this usually happens in the, right? And it might not apply to our context at all. Like one of the arguments that I was speaking to a gentleman named Ashish Dhar, and he's like, where is the right wing? He's like, that's not really the right wing. You know, it's definitely, say, an Indic wing or something like that. But it's the French Revolution left and right that America borrowed and then redefined do not necessarily transfer over to India at all.
Doesn't.
And right. And I think I found that part of what you were doing with your podcast is making people aware of something like that. You're trying to have a more nuanced discussion about stuff like that.
So what I say. So according to me, India does not have a right wing. What I call India has is the non-left. India definitely has a left wing. They are exactly like the left in the West. They behave exactly like them. They even cut, copy, paste their templates and superimpose them on India. Till the extent that Bombay, mein, when there were gun violence in America, there were people protesting gun violence in Bombay. I was like, gun hi nahi le sakte tum log yahan pe, kya baatein kar rahe ho?
Tum kar kya rahe ho? Tum caste ke liye lado na, wo kitna relevant hai, kitna proximate hai.
Wo thodi na, uske liye to अपर कास्ट आदमी कास्ट के लिए लड़ेगा लेफ्ट में. अरे यार, सी कड़वी सच्चाई जाना चाहते हो, लुक एट द एंटायर पैंथियन ऑफ एडिटर्स ऑफ लेफ्ट विंग पोर्टल्स इन इंडिया. कौन लोअर कास्ट है? लेते हैं वो. लुक एट द ऑल द बिग एडिटर्स इन इंडिया, सारे तो अपर कास्ट हैं. सबके सरनेम ले लो, मैं नाम नहीं लूंगा इधर, सबके सरनेम ले लो, जात पता चल जाएगी.
हमारे ये बड़ा ट्रांसपेरेंट सिस्टम है, सरनेम ले लो, जात पता चल जाएगी,
जात पता चल जाती है. तो हाँ. ये सब बातें बकवास है. मगर सी व्हाट, सो टू आंसर योर क्वेश्चन अबाउट व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू डू फ्रॉम माय पॉडकास्ट इज, आई एम ट्राइंग टू से दैट वी कैनॉट कॉपी पेस्ट वेस्टर्न मॉडल्स ऑन इंडिया. दैट डज नॉट मीन वी कैनॉट टेक एनीथिंग फ्रॉम देम,
राइट?
लाइक आई डेफिनेटली बिलीव दैट व्हेन इट कम्स टू फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन, द बेस्ट वर्किंग मॉडल अवेलेबल ऑन प्लैनेट अर्थ
राइट
नाउ इज द अमेरिकन मॉडल. And the gold standard has to be Brandenburg versus Ohio. That's it. That is the gold standard of freedom of expression. No other country in the world has a better argument for free speech. America has the best argument. Take it and respect it. That is the greatest argument ever. That's why I keep supporting that. That doesn't. I am not one of those Indic wing people who hates everything in the West. No, no, no.
Right.
I love the West. I love the West. I respect the West. It doesn't mean I'm a slave of the West. India does not have a right wing. What India has is different shades of the left. I believe India has two left wing parties or two left wing cultures. Both the left wing cultures, when it comes to economics, are socialists. Whether it's the Bharatiya Janata Party and the Congress or whatever, so many regional CPR, parties.
Right.
Sare ke sare different shades of the left. कोई एक्सट्रीम कम्युनिस्ट है तो कोई स्लाइटली कम्युनिस्ट सोशलिस्ट है,
ठीक
है? ये है,
राइट?
सो नाउ वेयर डज द डिफरेंस कम इन इंडियन पॉलिटिक्स, आई विल टेल यू. द इंडियन पॉलिटिक्स डिफरेंस आल्सो कम्स इन द रियलम ऑफ कल्चर. इवन इन द रियलम ऑफ कल्चर, एवरी इंडियन पॉलिटिकल पार्टी पैंडर्स टू सोशल कंजर्वेटिज्म. ओनली डिफरेंस कम्स इज विच सोशल कंजर्वेटिव दे पैंडर टू. सो व्हेन इट कम्स टू द कांग्रेस एंड द रेस्ट, राइट, बीजेपी को छोड़ दो, बीजेपी के अतिरिक्त जितनी पार्टियां हैं, दे पैंडर टू मुस्लिम, क्रिश्चियन, बेसिकली नॉन हिंदू कंजर्वेटिव्स. व्हेन इट कम्स टू द बीजेपी, सो बीजेपी पैंडर्स टू द इंडिक फेथ, बुद्धिज्म, जैनिज्म, सिखिज्म, हिंदुइज्म. इनके जो कंजर्वेटिव होते हैं ना, इनको बीजेपी एंड अकालीज केटर करते हैं. अकालीज ऑल्सो पैंडर टू हिंदू कंजर्वेटिव्स, बाय द वे, दे डोंट रिजेक्ट देम. Akalis nowadays have become very weird that they are pandering to the Muslim conservatives. This is a new development in their rejection of CAA, which was like, ye naya development hai, but it's okay.
Right.
But the entire base of politics in India is the same. Only difference is they're pandering to a different. So Congress, I mean, Congress is the liberal party of India, right? So-called liberal party. द महिला मोर्चा चीफ ऑफ कांग्रेस ऑन अ माइक सेज हम ट्रिपल तलाक वापस लाएंगे. ये लिबरलिज्म कब से हो गया?
हाँ, मतलब क्या लॉजिक है ये? हाउ कैन यू, हम लोग उनको उनके रिलीजियस राइट्स रीइंस्टेट करेंगे और ये हमारी लिबरलिज्म का टेस्ट है, और औरतों का क्या?
ये प्रॉब्लम है. अभी मैं आपको बीजेपी की हिपोक्रेसी बताता हूँ. हाँ, बीजेपी राइट विंग है.
हाँ,
और सबसे ज्यादा घटिया गवर्नमेंट की इंटरफेरेंस करने में बीजेपी एक्सपर्ट है. अगर बीजेपी राइट विंग है तो बीजेपी की, सी आई प्लेड अ गेम ऑन माय पॉडकास्ट विद टू गेस्ट. सो द गेम वाज सेट अप बाय मी एंड द गेस्ट. So what we did was, I told the guest that I'll try to guess which party it is. उसने मेरे को speeches पढ़ाई और policies पढ़ाई और उसने party का नाम change कर दिया. उसने बोला this person stands for this. What do you think this person is? और मजा आया, मैंने जब communist बोला वो person का नाम नरेंद्र मोदी निकला answer में. That's the reality. So it was a podcast I held with a guy called Ruchir Sharma. And we played this game. And I always say this to everybody who comes to you next time in your life in the US and says BJP is right wing. I tell them, let's play a game. I will remove the names of the parties from the manifesto. Manifesto padho, that is your document, your policy. See, I don't give a shit about anything else. What is your policy proposal? Policy proposal mein, both are pandering to social conservatism of a different kind. Both are pandering to socialism, absolute socialism. Farm loan levers, BJP bhi deta hai, Akali bhi deta hai, Congress bhi deta hai, Samajwadi bhi deta hai. These are all left-wing initiatives. Free healthcare, BJP bhi deta hai, Akali bhi deta hai, Congress bhi deta hai, sab kuch deta hai. Abhe difference kya hai? Difference lies in Uniform Civil Code, which funny enough should have been a liberal stand, but is a BJP stand in India, so-called.
Right.
Triple talaq should have been a liberal stand, but BJP says BJP that. And Ram Mandir is an issue. And Article 370 is an issue. Other than that, there is nothing that differentiates these. India does not have a right wing. India, you can say BJP is more nativist in comparison to others. That I'm willing to buy, that BJP panders to the nativists more. And that also is not in the racial sense, but in the religio-cultural sense, where,
right.
And the biggest difference I believe in Indian politics is that Indian politics has not yet defined the identity of India. As per the Congress, India was a conglomeration of different prants who were united only by the British. There was no conceptual India, and it only became one entity by the British. And this is the constitution that binds us. The BJP, which comes from the Hindutva RSS argument, which I am more sympathetic to, albeit I am very opposed to Hindutva in many ways. And that's why I don't call myself Hindutva. But the BJP argument says that we are not a British entity. We are a civilizational entity where we have something called, I think even Diana Eck has written about it in her book, where they call it a sacred geography. And they have an argument that if we did not have a sacred geography, then why did Adi Shankaracharya establish his pithams all across the country? He did have a concept of sacred geography. Like he went from south all the way to north. Why did he not go only one West. Area?
Right.
He went all over the country. Puri country mein pithams hai. Similarly, there are other things that are available all across the country. So there was this concept of the sacred in India. They say we are a continuing civilization. And that's the only difference. The difference between Indian political parties is the identity, the cultural nature of India. That's the only difference between them. Otherwise, actually at a political level, they are just the same, pandering to different groups. That's all it is. To me, there is no right wing in India. India has left wing parties. One is a left wing nativist. One is a left wing confusion. That's all it is. And people need it. See, the global left, they are the ones who basically do the narrative setting at a global level. Look, I'll give you an example. So now you're in a university. So do this. Try to go to your university and find out who has control over the Hinduism studies department. You'll get the shock of your life. It will be a bunch of goras who will be telling you what Hinduism is. Notice,
Karna, I have taken classes with a bunch of goras on Hinduism.
Yeah, so but now do the opposite. Go to the China studies department. Go to the Arabic studies department. Go to the Japanese studies department. There will be a native Japanese telling you what Japan is. There will be a native Chinese telling you what China is. There will be a native Arab telling you what Arab culture is. Only in India have these people taken the liberty, and the blame lies with us, not with them, because we never took it. And what they get, see, they have to show some brown people working for them. So what they have done is they have taken their clones in brown people who literally copy their men. See, what they have done is they have picked up, let's say, a scholar from India who's basically downloaded their software into this brain, and that's how they're controlling. So the identity crisis of India stems from this. Does that mean we have nothing to learn from the West? At least I'm not one of those people. I'm very open. I vote for the BJP. I don't think so. It is a thought crime to share your voting leanings. I will never hide it.
Right.
But does that mean I am for anti-Muslim bigotry? Hell no. And anybody can see my tweets and they will understand what kind of a person I am. I'm a vehement critic of religion, but I criticize Hinduism too. It's just that when I criticize Islam, logon ko mirchi lagti hai. But when I talk brutally about caste, kisi ko mirchi nahi lagti hai. But the point is, I believe India will take time. India does not have right-wing politics. But India, where is the fiscally conservative party in India? There was one Swatantra party. Minu Masani, Rajagopalachari and all those people tried to push it. But wo to khatam ho gayi. So, koi hai nahi. India does not have a right-wing. It has an Indic wing. So, Ashish Dhar is right when he says, I call it the nativist wing. I'm just trying to be more terminologically
accurate. Right.
Accurate. Mm-hmm. But I think Ashish has a very valid point there. And even within the nativist wing, there is heavy differences. Mm-hmm. Heavy differences. Mm-hmm. Even within that wing about the conceptualization. So, you know, a lot of times people accuse that, BJP will make India a Hindu Rashtra.
Right.
Okay. So my next question to them is, and to both sides, I always do this, define Hindu Rashtra. And then they get confused. They say it will become a theological state where the constitution will be drawing principles from theology. I was like, okay. I was like, then will it be Vaishnavite? So that means kanda lasun nahi allow karenge. Jain hoga ki kanda lasun aur everything else bhi nahi allow karenge jo underground ugate hain.
Right. Alu bhi nahi kha sakte.
I was like, what Hindu Rashtra are you talking about? So, will it be the Hindu Rashtra of the lower caste where even non-veg and meat is allowed?
No, let me ask you this. Hindutva Rashtra, matlab, political Hindu identity has been consolidated with Hindutva. Suppose, koi banda bolta hai, ki yaar phir Hindutva Rashtra bana rahe, Hindu Rashtra nahi. What do you say to that?
Hindutva Rashtra bhi kaise banayenge? Because Hindutva ka kya matlab tha? Hindutva ka matlab Savarkar ke hisab se tha ki Savarkar was interested in creating a political identity which became a which kind. See, you cannot control the diversity in Hindus. The moment you try to homogenize Hindus, they will kick you in the butt and they will go away. They love their diversity too much. No matter how much anybody says, I will reject that. The BJP, see, in my experience, so now somebody will say, Golwalkar nahi ye bola hai, Golwalkar nahi ye bola. Yes, I agree. I reject all those paragraphs of Golwalkar where he peddles anti-Muslim bigotry. But people forget the fact that it was the same Golwalkar who said, I don't agree with those thoughts anymore. Stop selling my books. Same Golwalkar who said that too. But does that mean those thoughts are wrong? No. And secondly, Mohan Bhagwat recently made a speech last year where he said, we don't need to agree with Golwalkar. He's not our Bhagwan. We will take what I agree from Golwalkar and I will reject. So that's a very typical Hindu thing to do. Take the good, baki ka kachre mein dal do. So my point is the Hindutva Rashtra will also be like a Hindu Rashtra. See, always remember, a fundamentalist of a religion will be like the fundamentals of a religion. So at worst, a Hindu fundamentalist will be casteist. At worst. Slightly misogynist. At worst. Because even the misogyny between Hinduism and Islam is not comparable. Oh my God, it is not. Not that it is not there in Hinduism. I am categorically saying there is absolute misogyny in Hindu texts.
Right.
And anybody who says it is not there, bhaiya, padh lo. Padh lo. Main tumko itne sare words bata dunga ki tum thak jaoge. But the point is, it is not. So Hindus will come back. Magar Islam jaisa nahi hai. Main, so fir I give them the cricket analogy. I was like, tumhari halat ye ho gayi hai ki main Zimbabwe se to achha hu na cricket mein. Maine bola, ye koi comparison hai kya?
Right. Pakistan mein kitne log mar rahe hain corona virus mein? Abe ye koi comparison hai kya? Ki matlab agar mere news channel ye dikha rahe hain ki Pakistan mein kitne log mar rahe hain, are we really even comparing ourselves with the right audience? So I had a question, right? I've noticed throughout what you've been saying that part of your effort, and I do not know if this is part of your effort when you were hosting yours, but at least in our conversation is that, so Prakhar, my point is X, but I'm not saying Y. and I'm not saying Z, I'm saying X. Like there is this, I've been seeing this need to be accurate with what you're trying to say and an insistence upon that accuracy. And I understand from our previous conversation as well that this is because you have a taste for nuance. You do not have a taste for provocation. You have a taste for nuance. And that is the nuance that you're trying to get across. And my bet would be that the reason why you landed on a podcasting enterprise is because you understood that this is where I could have nuanced conversation.
Absolutely.
Right? I landed on a podcasting. I started podcasting a year and a half ago or something like that, right? Like a joke before, and then it became like a thing 6 months after. So I've been podcasting for, and when I started podcasting, my mother asked me a question that I think is very relevant to people in general. And she was like, why are you doing this? What is it that you have discovered that other people have not? And my question to you after 3 years of podcasting now is, what have you discovered that the media, the traditional legacy media who is displaying Pakistan ke coronavirus numbers has not even yet begun to understand? Why is it that you are doing what you are doing? You are having complex conversations. You are making sure you are getting across properly. What is it that you've discovered that everybody else has not?
See, to be very honest, I started podcasting. So I'll give you the history. So 6 years ago, I'll tell you. So it has nothing to do, but I'm just narrating a story. And that's the thing. You can narrate a story in a podcast because we have the beauty of time.
Right.
So I grew up with two sports, cricket. And one was, my love was boxing. I'm the generation which my father grew, I grew up with watching Mike Tyson with my father. And, I'm only a fan of two people, Sachin Tendulkar and I and Mike Tyson. Nothing else matters to me. These two people matter to me. I'm very sensitive about two people, Sachin Tendulkar and Mike Tyson. then there was the era where, the 90s era was the best boxing era. And then the Russian boxers, Vitaly Klitschko and Vladimir Klitschko, the Klitschko brothers took over boxing, and boxing became boring and I stopped watching combat. Then, because I used to watch WWE for entertainment, then I found out, Brock Lesnar left WWE and he went to the UFC. And then I started watching UFC. And from UFC, I started watching sports podcasts, which would discuss UFC, like shows. And then from there, the YouTube recommendations accidentally put me across to some podcasts. And then I was like, because I stopped watching news as a concept 6 years ago. I got so fed up of people shouting at each other. And this has nothing to do with Arnab Goswami at an individual level. He has a role to play in society. People may not like him. Not that I am a fan of him. I don't know him as a person. I'm just talking about Arnab the image. I can't watch him. But I was turned off from news television even before that. Because I am someone who was raised by my father to be a truth seeker. And my mother, who taught me to be a truth seeker, and even my elder brother, who probably has been my biggest influence in my life, who always taught me to question things. So for me, when I suddenly accidentally came across even sports podcast, I was like, oh wow, isme question puchte 10 minute answer dene ko milta hai. Ye bahut acha hai. And then I started, then I came across Dave Rubin, then I came across Pod Save America, then I came across obviously the giant Joe Rogan. And then, as the rest, as they say, is history. And I started consuming podcasts. For the first 3 years, I was only a consumer of podcasts. I still listen to at least 4 to 5 hours of podcasts religiously. Like daily, 4 to 5 hours, I listen to content.
What are you listening these days? Who do you listen to these days?
So many. I mean, I will listen to Sam Harris, Science Salon. There is a philosophy podcast called the PanSciCast. Then I listen to a Desi podcast called Brown Pundits. I love that podcast. Then obviously on the non-left, there's a very good show of a friend of mine. We co-host a show together, to Shyam Sharma's show.
Right.
Another science podcast I listen to is the Insight podcast, on and off, not very regularly. Then I listen to a lot of MMA podcasts. Like I'm a massive MMA nut. So I listen to like 3 podcasts of MMA and everything. So I just, my day goes in 4 to, I don't watch movies, a lot of movies. I don't watch a lot of shows. My actual time goes in podcasting. I love listening to it. Like the whole idea. So I got attracted. This is what I found in podcasting. You can look at a point and you can talk about it for 1 hour without caring about anything. And you can actually, I call it, peeling the layers. You keep on peeling and you learn new things. What I realized is, like, I'm an avid reader. I try to read at least 3 to 4 books a month. That's my target. I want to clock at least 40 plus books every year. The more I read, the more I listen, the more I realize, the less I know. And it keeps on making me epistemically humble. Not that I'm stupid, but just that I want to know more and I keep on going there. And that's what pushed me eventually, that I had so many questions in my head that I was like, main karu kya iska? Ab main Barkha Dutt to honi, mere ko koi channel to dega nahi. And the internet's beauty is it has democratized discourse. Democratized till the extent ki har gadha bhi aa gaya hai.
Right.
But it's a good thing because we know who the gadha is now. The point is that's why, because I started podcasting is because I had so many questions. And then obviously I started with a type of guest, and then the journey kept on going. And a lot of people told me, oh, who's going to listen to 1 hour conversations? I was like, you don't get it. I don't do it for you.
Right.
I do it for me.
Yes.
When I talk to someone in a podcast, I love it. Yes. I love listening to them. I love listening to their answers. And I don't agree with them, but I still want to. So my whole aim was that here was a platform where people were not calling each other bigots. People were not calling each other bad things. And they were trying to genuinely understand each other. In our old school ways, it is called Uttar Paksh, Purva Paksh. Purva Paksh is when you actually present the argument of the opposite side the way they would present it.
Steel
manning. Steel manning. And then Uttar Paksh. And then answer.
Right.
So what happens on TV is straw manning. Mm. What happens on social media is straw manning. What I saw on podcast was steel manning.
Right.
And it changed the game. Yeah. And I loved it. I loved the idea. And I mean, not that my podcast is not big, but I don't care about what it is. Mm-hmm. What I care about is that all I know is I'm the only guy apparently who does it. Mm-hmm. I hardly know people who does it. I was one of the first ones to start it. And I kept on doing it. I mean, one of the first ones in the non-left to do it. And I talk about everything. So I'll talk about cricket. I'll talk about religion. I will talk about politics. I will talk about anything I want to talk about. My whole criteria is I should find my guest interesting. If I find that person interesting, they'll be on my podcast. So if I like a book, a lot of podcasters, and I know that for a fact, that they don't read a book before they call them on the podcast. They just read the reviews and then read the show notes. No. I have a rule that if you're coming on my podcast, I will not invite you until I have not read your book. I read the book. So I will read whether it's 500 pages or 1,000 pages. I'll read the bloody thing. Only then will I invite you on my podcast. Otherwise, for me, this is a personal project which I love. I absolutely love it. And I'm not doing it for anybody other than myself. If in the process other people enjoy it, thumbs up. If nobody enjoys it, I'll still go on doing it.
Right. That's at least with my age, people often ask me if I'm a content creator with my podcast. And my whole point is I don't care. I haven't looked at my numbers in forever. I don't care who's listening to this conversation. I'm sure there's people listening to it. I have a significant amount of listener base. For me, it is that I get to ask questions to people I would never have gotten the opportunity to ask those questions to. It's like in one weird sense, podcasting right now in India, where the mindset that who's going to watch a 1 hour long conversation is a networking tool, and not even networking. It's when the transition from straw manning to steel manning allows for the flow of truth to be better through discourse, right? Now we're not stuck at level one where we're trying to oppose each other's straw man assumptions. Now we are moving forward. I can sit with the friction of our disagreement. I can be like, so Kushal, build your argument up. And then I can be like, but this is what I think. And that too can happen in a polite manner because we are not constrained by what people want to watch. And that's what you were saying earlier, right? Your approach to your podcast is quite the opposite of what the traditional approach to media is. Give the people what they want. You were like, I don't care what the people want. I don't even want to have a clickbait title. I want to do what I want. And if somebody comes along, they come along. And that is sort of the freedom that you've allowed yourself. And that has, in some sense, paid you back as well. I've heard some podcasts that you've done and they were fantastic. I learned so much. Not even that. Even through just this conversation, I learned so much. I'm curious to ask you if there is any way. Say if there is somebody who's listening to this, who's still old Kushal, who's still watching news, who's still absorbed in the lowest common denominator, the low resolution image of the world. If there is any way you can articulate the difference, the delta between Kushal 6 years ago and now through the means of consuming and then doing podcasting, how has it changed the way you think? How has it changed the way you live in the sense of, let's just say, truth as a data point? How has that changed all of that for you?
I think I'm happier today. I used to be very angry when I used to watch news.
Right.
I had convinced myself, which still most people on social media and news media have convinced, that they are in some war. Because when I look at data year after year, moment after moment, India is getting, so I'll give you an example, even riots, not that riots are a good thing, but nowadays when riots happen in India, far less people die than previously. I mean, data is data. I'm not making shit up. Every day, more and more people come out of poverty in India. Violence is reducing in India, not increasing. The number seems to be spiking because we don't realize that reportage has increased in India because India has become better. 20 years ago, the amount of trouble to file an FIR was 1,000 times more than the amount of trouble to file an FIR in a police thana today. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying it is easy even today. We have 1,000 miles to travel there. But what I'm saying is it's better. So when a lot of people are getting pulled out of poverty in India, but the brain still yearns conflict, right? So I think we still, because we have, our brain has a negativity bias, right? I mean, in cricket, Dhoni can take 4 great catches, but we'll only remember the catch he dropped in the match.
The one he missed. Yes, 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 yes.
I mean, that's just the brain, the way the brain has evolved, because it used to help the hunter-gatherer in the jungle.
Right.
That's how he would or she would avoid all those, you know, sudden attacks from animals or serpents or whatever. The point is that since I've stopped consuming news, and I'm not saying you should be like me, you should watch news if you like watching news. But the point is that don't buy what they're selling. Watch it. Like my wife watches Arnab. She thinks it's hilarious what he does. She actually watches it as a stand-up comedy show. I think she's not laughing. She's like, wow, what a joker. That's right. What she says. Right. That's her choice. She thinks it's so funny. Now, after a long time, I actually found some reportage absolutely top class. What is that Vion channel? Yeah, Vion. I don't know how to pronounce it. What a beautiful channel. I was like, this is good reporting. So I'll call it nice. So it depends. Everybody has a role to play in society. But my whole thing is, if you consume that, but start listening to long-form conversations if you want more nuance, because life is not black and white. Life itself is pretty much in different shades of gray. Not that there is no objective truth. There are. It's not like you should allow flat earthers in a physics conference. No, Baba.
Flat earth. There is a core of objective truth.
There is a core of objective truth. But what I'm trying to say is there are many realms here. And if you are so... My answer to everybody who asks me, why don't you consume news, is like, I can't handle it anymore. The idea of, you know, boss, when I talk to someone, I want to see the best in you. And the whole idea presented on news television is, you are a monster, you are a monster, you are a monster, you are a monster. That's a very unhappy way to live your life.
Yes,
being happy. It's very simple. I'm selfish. I like being happy. And the data doesn't show India is becoming worse daily. The data shows India is becoming better daily in most parameters. Yes, climate change, I'm worried about. But in most parameters, India is becoming better. We need to create a culture of intelligent conversations. I don't think mainstream media is going to make that. I think India, just like America, is going to go to podcasting. Maybe it won't be my podcast, and that's okay. It could be some other podcast. As long as it's long form, it's intelligent. Believe me, I've heard a few Indian podcasts without naming them. They're not smart. They're just talking for a long time. But that the whole idea of a podcast, your main aim has to be that you come from a space of humility here. You have to be genuinely convinced that the other side has something to offer to you. You don't have to be smug that, "Arey, aaja main teri leta hun." You don't come from that gotcha kind of a feeling. I somehow our cultural zeitgeist in India, every time somebody interviews the other person, is, "I want to get you." Even in podcasts, it happens, by the way. I've seen it in interviews done by news portals on YouTube where they're trying to get the other person. like a left-leaning journalist is trying to get the other person, or a right-leaning journalist is trying to get the other person. I don't like any of that. If you want to, if you love India, you care for India, drop the malice. And then let's talk. And then I think it'll be done. Maybe I'm weird. I don't know. But that's how I am.
I have a private belief that I've never really questioned publicly. I want to see if that makes sense to you. What I realized from podcasting. So part of the deal that you're mentioning is that the way I conceptualize is that the media space understands that everybody has to put on a performance. And it's not just the media space, but the consumers, they also understand that this performance is viable. The reason probably why your wife finds Arnab funny is because that veil has broken. Where she's like, I get it that this is a performance and this performance not real Arnab, and that's why he's funny. This is not real reportage, right? We sort of understand that media figures have to somehow put on a performance, a character, a show, right? With podcasting, because I started off very anti that. I felt very betrayed by the media. Every time somebody would ask me for my political opinion, I'd be like, I don't know how to answer that question. The information I've gotten is corrupted, and I know it's corrupted. So when I started podcasting and I started pursuing political questions with people who are way smarter than I am, I realized that every time I'd speak to somebody, something inside me would adjust. There would be a newer conception, a newer reality. There would be another data point in the constellation of data points. I would synthesize that, make sense of that. And I realized it's not just me. Quite possibly the other person slightly changes their mind as well in the course of articulating their beliefs. And what that got me to thinking was that if we could shed that performance and meet as people and talk about things that are important, we realize that we are not as fixated on what we think. We are pretty flexible. Most people do not exist in the right or the left or the center. Like you were saying, I think the right way, what people started doing with the intellectual dark web phenomena was calling themselves centrists. I don't think centrist is a right way to put yourself. I think it's politically open. I think most of us are very flexible with our political choices, in the sense that if you convince me for something that seems reasonable and accurate and, you know, and non-malicious, I will be convinced to that. And I think part of what traditional media gets wrong, or for that matter, a lot of political commentators on alternate media, be that podcasting, YouTube, or whatever, get wrong, is that they're I don't get how somebody can be so convinced of their political views. I think political decisions flower in retrospect. There is almost no way of knowing, prima facie, if CAA, NRC is going to be as bad a demon as you think it is going to be, unless you let it happen for a couple of years. Maybe this might be, you know, like the prospective and the retrospect look absolutely different. And in politics, it is so difficult for me to understand how people are confident about their views entirely. I will say something politically, but I will always disclaim it by saying, this is what I think right now. And this is the evidence. This is the data that I use to think like this right now. And my mind will change if this, I will do the homework enough to tell you how my mind and why my mind will change too, if I'm given some contradictory evidence, right? Have you found that to be, do I make sense when I present that hypothesis? Is that a reasonable thing to think? Do you think?
No, definitely. You have valid points there. See, you have to understand, but people don't look at politics like you do. People look at politics as a zero-sum game. Mm. So, like I said,
I think politics is a zero-sum game, right?
It is a zero-sum game. So your news reportage, first of all, what you have on primetime these days is not reportage. Right. This is shouting matches. What has that got to do with the news anyways? They're not even conducting debates. That is not how to do a debate also.
Yes.
What we have as news channels in India is a filthy joke.
Right.
It is ridiculous. It is disgusting. It is demeaning to human beings. And there is no right-minded person can justify it. I mean, I don't know what people find in it. I just don't get it. I don't get it. If you want to reach solutions, the only way you reach solutions is when you sit across the table and you talk with each other. Yahan pe to koi baat hi nahi karta hai. They shout at each other. They attribute malice. And it's a zero-sum game where it's either my way or the other. And I find it so un-Hindu. I mean, for a society that has basically even today got around 84% dharmic Indic faiths, it is the most adharmic, un-Indic way of behaving, how we are behaving on news channels. I mean, what kind of behavior is this? I don't get it, but everybody is their own way. So I see no merit in this way of engaging.
Right.
And what you're trying to do is the right way, but unfortunately, the point is maybe the society is not ready, the society is not prepared for it. I always say this when my analysis of the Hindu society, a major section of the Hindu society suffers from two disorders. The left-wing Hindu suffers from Stockholm syndrome, and the non-left Hindu suffers from a post-traumatic stress disorder. The non-left Hindu has taken that 1,000-year rule by external forces too much and is not able to get over the trauma of that 1,000-year rule. And the left-wing Hindu has fallen in love with the invader so much that they have lost their objectivity.
Right. Both of them have lost their objectivity.
Yeah, so both of them have lost their objectivity. It's a fight between Stockholm syndrome and post-traumatic stress disorder. Both are shouting at each other. And people who are not suffering from either disorder are just looking at there and like, kya ho raha bhai? That's what's my understanding. Could be wrong, and I'm open to be corrected.
I have one final question. And that's maybe it's a very speculative question. So feel free to could it be hypothetically that the reason why our news media space is so adharmic is that the competitive pressures of capitalism in a saturated market do not really go well with dharma? Like my feeling is that the media space is now so saturated that the competitive pressure is in fact theatrics, dramatics, dressing up as a soldier and holding like a fake AK-47. And so I think, right. Like what is happening? Oh my gosh. Like how, so it could be that, there is sort of a disorder of that nature that is being coupled at the forefront of that saturation. But those were the gist of my questions. Do you have any questions for me?
I totally agree with you. I think it is the nature of the market. The market, everybody is convinced that apparently shouting on television is the right way, and that is the only way you are going to get numbers on television. The moment podcasters start getting numbers, you'll see television toned down. Mark my words.
They will change as hell. Yes, absolutely agree.
They will tone down. They will become quiet. यार हम बड़े हुए सिर्फ डीडी देखते थे यार ठीक थी लाइफ यार ला रहे क्यों हो
Have you seen that one clip where there's I think a Pakistani guy, Indian guy, और वो made वो छोटे-छोटे rockets लेके लड़ रहे हैं TV screen से मैं तेरे को मार दूंगा ओ सरदारा मैं तेरे को मार दूंगा मैं कह रहा हूँ यार
ये कर रहा था What the hell was that? I mean that was the absolute pits of Indian television. I just gave up. After that I gave up. So it's, I think, that's pretty much it. If you ask me, podcasting is in India at a stage where it was in 2009-10 in America. It was just starting. Podcasting exploded in America just around the time Donald Trump became the president. And today podcasting, I mean, imagine did you ever think that Bill Maher for his new season of Real Time will go to Rogan for the launch? But not go to mainstream media. He knew. Right. I mean, this is where the audience is now.
My mind got blown because I listened to Rogan and I understood the kind of influence that he had and the humility with which he wielded that influence, at least prime of a side. I was like, you know what? I thought all power corrupts. Maybe if I can keep myself out of the equation long enough, the influence that I will garner will not, like I thought power is, or corruption is embedded in power. But he gives me hope in a very limited way that there is one way. If you authentically deal with it, if you deal with it humbly, if you deal with it, if you wield it properly, that you can cause real tectonic shifts in the way the world thinks. So I think he's genuinely a very powerful man. I think his power is in the fact that he's so much an average Joe. Like his questions are the questions that I would have thought if I was sitting there. That is the feeling I get. And I think he stands for what he thinks is right and wrong. And I really have respect for that kind of journalism.
He's genuinely curious.
He's not trying to put on a show. Right. All right, Kushal. Thank you so much. This has been fantastic.
Pleasure was mine. Thanks for calling me.